This is Mike Nawrocki.
And Kurt Heinecke.
Hello, everybody. How you doing? Welcome to the end of silliness.
Is it the end of silliness?
It could be. We don't know.
I hear sad music and there's rain falling.
This project was had a couple different inspirations. One was the Edward Hopper painting Nighthawks, which has been used for many different things. Bugs Bunny used it years ago, and I've seen it in other animated pieces.
But, well, then you always see it in the chintzy art stores with neon Marilyn Monroe stuck
right,
into
right, exactly, and Elvis. Yeah. So, but which actually is a painting at the Chicago Art Institute. So we've got it right here in Chicago, and so we thought we'd use it too. And the other thing was for the cheeseburger song, which Larry's having flashbacks right here. There's the cheeseburger
Boy, this is
song.
Pretty bizarre, Mike.
Yeah, it's just it's a freak out. Look at that bubbly Larry. No, bubbly Archie. Sorry, but we actually got a petition from a radio station in Duluth, Minnesota, after Madam Blueberry came out. It was called Save Our Silly Songs, and this host had actually collected a bunch of signatures from people around Duluth and one person in Moose Lake, Minnesota.
Ah.
And Moose Lake would later play a very prominent role in VeggieTales episodes.
Yes, it continues to play.
Because Larry just loved that name, Moose Lake, Minnesota.
Mm-hmm.
And so... So basically, taking those two concepts and combining them into the end of silliness, and the question is asked at the beginning and then answered at the end via this petition. So, but we thought at first that was a really intense way to start.
Yes, and I remember this was such a dramatic switch from that.
Uh-huh.
And there were kazoos playing and slide whistles. And it just comes to the stark tuba of Larry.
Yeah, that still makes me laugh. I really like that.
Okay, I've talked about it before, but. For once, I can comment it as it's actually played. Here's a mistake right there that we actually kept in. That's an example of playing poorly on purpose to give a realism to the level of Larry's playing abilities. Right?
Right. Right. Oh, here, and we see VeggieTales on the bottom of the screen, just in case you don't know the words.
Wait, there was yellow.
Yeah, and the original sing-along, they went from white to green. And from here, they go from... where do they go from?
I'm really confused.
Oh, yeah, well, okay. Oh, they go from yellow to white.
But then half of them aren't changing.
Well, that's because it's the only thing being sung when the single words are on. See, VeggieTales?
Okay,
it's the only thing being sung. So it's, you're only supposed to sing when you see white.
Oh, man,
only
I'm
sing
confused.
When you see the whites of their letters. Is that Paul Revere? Who said that?
No, that was another one of those
revolutionary
guys. I know who you're talking about, though.
Yeah. So here we are. Larry has had way too many sundaes, way too many ice cream sundaes.
There was actually a lot of this, dialogue set up for the show, which I always am impressed with you and Phil always. It's not just a, collection of some of our old songs, but you take the time to put in a pretty in-depth story here of what's going on and tying them together.
We had a lot of fun just, with just this whole backstory and, Larry dealing with the fact that he could, that he's lost his silly songs. So.
Well, this was fun to write the score for this because I got to play saxophone, which I don't get to do that often.
Mm-hmm.
And then just add some bizarre, those dream sequences. And just add in a lot of string effects and noisemakers and all sorts of stuff to capture some of that. I hope we didn't scare any little kitties with that or get them too depressed.
I like the cool retro jukebox, too.
Was that inspired by an actual, television screen type design from...
From the Edward Hopper painting? No, actually, in that original painting, there's no jukebox.
I thought there was a TV in the Edward Hopper painting.
No,
I mean,
no.
Isn't that like an old, 1950s style of television screen?
Right, yeah, plopped on. If there would be video jukeboxes in the 1950s, they would likely
look
like that.
In Edward Hopper paintings.
And, yeah.
They would look just like that.
Look just like that.
Who did the... Is this your drawings or...
No, these are... Dan Lopez did these drawings.
Okay.
And they're just really, really funny drawings. So, and he did them in watercolor style, all in Painter.
Mm-hmm.
I think Painter 4, that was
so even though they look like they're hand-drawn, they're still computer animation.
Well, no, they were hand-drawn, and then he scanned them in and then painted them.
Wait, there's numbers there on that
yes,
negative.
Yes, that was code. That was code. Yes. See if you can translate the code and see what it says.
Translate the numbers secret. To letters and write in your response.
Well, see, now, on the video that we did previous to this, which was the... which was the original silly sing-along, you know, the very first sing-along, mm-hmm. a very silly sing-along. I had edited that right before I went to Columbia with my wife, and I got my bad back. I told that story
from
in
the
previous one.
Yep,
from
you have
the,
to buy the previous
my,
one to get that
my
story.
My mom's rattan chair. And then we no, went to Columbia.
I'm sorry, I'm breaking in. That's not an equal sign. That is a...
Similar to, or, similar or to. About equal, yeah.
I don't
so,
remember that from math.
Don't you remember that? But anyway, so we went to Columbia, and I had a bad back the whole time because of the chair from editing the previous sing-along. And I wrote Cebu, started writing that in Columbia because I saw these Cebus, these creatures that I'd never seen before. And I thought they were funny, and I wanted to write a song about them.
And weren't you, I remember you saying you saw them, you were walking down the street to get ice cream.
Yeah.
And they were like walking the other way.
Yeah, yeah. We had gone out with a group of friends to get ice cream. And they were walking back from the ice cream store, and so I started imagining.
So they went to the ice cream store too?
Probably not.
Okay.
No, but I imagined that they were coming back from the ice cream store because they were walking in the opposite direction that we were walking, and we were going to get ice cream.
Uh huh.
But you know the Cebus, they're typically found in the hot weather towns in Colombia, and my wife is from Bogota, where it's about 75 degrees all year long. So it's kind of, you know, room temperature all year. And, you know, we go down the mountain to these hot weather towns and we would see these Cebus, and they weren't the healthiest looking creatures I'd ever seen.
Like those, you know, pictures.
Yeah.
There.
So I, you know, got this version of them. They were all just kind of sickly. So we have a sick Cebu, a sad Cebu, and a mute Cebu. So,
well, it all makes sense now.
Doesn't all make sense?
Yeah.
And I did go to, I went to a bullfight. But it wasn't an actual typical bullfight that you see where, you know, you have the matador that kills the bull at the end.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a bunch of guys running away from bulls. So,
was it a PC bullfight?
No, well, they weren't full-grown bulls. They were juvenile bulls. So they were just big enough to maim you and not kill you. And so
were they in the ring?
Yeah, they were in the ring.
So
and they
like
actually wanted
the
me
streets.
To be in the ring, too.
Uh-huh.
And my wife was like, get out, stay out of the ring, because my back was bad. You know, so I'm here hobbling along.
So if the back hadn't been bad, you'd have been in that ring.
Well, I did go in the ring, and I just stayed, you know, I stayed along the sides, you know, by the sides of the corral. And every time the bull would start coming, I just hop on the fence like a scared girl.
Okay.
And not to say that girls, you know, wouldn't be bullfighters, you know.
Uh-huh, careful there,
but I screamed like a girl.
Okay.
And so I'd just get out of their way, and my wife was like, get out of there. But yeah, it was actually kind of thrilling, you know, to
a
run away from
adrenaline
a
rush.
Juvenile bull. If it was a full-grown bull, it would have just been completely insane. But
uh-huh.
But it was kind of fun. But everybody kept saying, you know, because I'm so tall, you know, everybody kept saying in Spanish, you know, just spread your legs apart and the bull will run underneath your legs.
Yeah,
underneath
right.
Your legs.
you show me how it's done.
Yeah, I didn't take their advice.
That was a fun song to do, by the way.
Oh, yeah. That was cool. You did a great job with that.
Well, you had brought some real neat ideas to it, and then to kind of combine the fun ethnic and the contemporary dance beat.
Yeah, it was a fun one.
It's one of my favorites.
They got them mixed up at Photo Hut.
But it's not a big deal. So you messed up a song.
Guess we should
is he so he's the
talking.
Soda jerk, right?
Yeah, he's the soda jerk.
You know why he's called a jerk?
No. Is there a trivia
it's
behind that?
It's not because he's a jerk. It's because that's the motion you use to turn on the
oh,
machines
really?
Back
oh,
there,
wow.
The seltzer water or whatever it was.
Wow.
I learned
cool.
That. See, there's one of those. See, when you pull that down on the right back there,
okay.
That's a jerking motion. That's thanks to the food channel that my wife watches.
Wow. We should do some Iron Chef references.
That could be a show inspiration. Mm-hmm.
We had to actually render these texture maps onto that TV, and we'd render them to a point where we had a natural cut in the show. So as soon as the first cut comes, then we'll cut in full frame on the right here.
Oh
yeah,
boy!
See, video tricks.
And there's a kazoo. This is mostly sequenced in the background, but it was fun to use kazoo, and we used some slide whistle, and was talking about this before, and just the sense of, you know, what just gives a real fun, celebratory, wacky party feel.
Yep.
Party noises, kazoos, right. Whistles, slide whistles.
Yep. This is a little bit like the bunny song, just in the sense of everything else fades to black and you got a lot of colorful spotlights pointed on the characters.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this was very nice.
That was an impressive plate of pintos and cheese going by, too. Makes me
and
want
I like
to go
how
to Taco
you go
Bell.
Into the pupil. There's actually this much going on inside his head.
Mm-hmm. A little bit of Be Our Guest right there. This was a fun song to do on the, we did this in the live show, VeggieTales Live.
And, yes.
I remember the, a lot of the props. It was great. I mean, the set design was really fun for this, and they had a lot of these just really fun food props that would wheel across the stage, and the sheep would bring them across.
And then what fell, something fell from the ceiling. Was that the manna? Didn't she catch the manna?
Oh, boy.
Falls from the sky?
Yeah, I can't remember. It could have been.
You hope she catches it.
Yep.
I love that. It's Kristen Blagan singing the voice of Laura the Carrot.
Laura the Carrot. That's right.
I love that little voice.
This was a fun song. At the end of it, you'll notice that it feels a little jumpy because we didn't have time to render this whole song. This was one of the last things rendering when we were doing Rack Shack and Benny, and we just didn't have the computer time. And so instead of, typically you'll have 30 frames a second in video, we now actually render at 24 frames a second and then do what's called a pull down. We rendered all this in 30 frames a second. But since we didn't have time to finish the rendering, we started rendering at 15 frames a second. So we would only render every other frame and then hold a frame.
Mm-hmm.
And so by the end of this, as we're pulling away and doing the final shot, you know, it feels really jerky because of that. It was only half of the frames are there. I like the little ear pulls on that.
I know,
it's nice.
That's cute.
Any interesting musical stories about this one?
None at all. Actually, I remember this show vividly, though, because it was, as they were going through the tunnels and the chase scenes, it was one of our first real big scoring shows where we needed an intense score, a lot of movement, and when Phil was directing that and I was writing that, neither of us had had a lot of experience with that yet. We were kind of learning as we went. Plus, just like the animation was a little more rudimentary back then, the musical side of it was a little more rudimentary also, with having much less computing power. I had, in this one, I had no live instrumentation to use, so everything is sequenced. And having a orchestration and a band directing and live playing background, you know, it's, you got to find that balance, because I was never happy. Okay, now we're starting to...
Okay, here we go. Here, we'll go to the every other frame. Okay, you can tell really soon. Still going at full frame there. There we go. Oh, hey, wait a second. I wonder if that was re-rendered at some point. Maybe they pulled that back in and re-rendered it.
Because I remember seeing it.
Maybe I just don't notice. Yeah.
No, I remember seeing it, too.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Real quickly before this one, yeah, just saying that it was hard for me to have to... You know, not have a lot of budget and not a lot of time at times to not be able to, hey, there's Mike. I mean, there's Phil and Lisa.
Yep. Those are the caricatures of Phil and Lisa.
So it's been fun over the years to be able to start adding more live instrumentation, and the computing power has gotten stronger so we can do so much more.
Yeah.
But I've always tried to, you know, be as musical as we can and let the song and the lyrics and the story speak. And that's why these have been so much fun to do. This was a great show.
Yeah,
is this your first directing one?
Well, this is the first show, the first story that I wrote all the way through.
Yeah.
And I did have, for Madame Blueberry, that's actually a concept that I had from the very beginning of VeggieTales. You know, I'm So Blue.
Mm-hmm.
I remember, I think I wrote that song before the theme song, before the VeggieTales theme song, at least the main part of that.
Well, that was the first show I had scored with you. And it's funny just getting started and trying to find your rhythm and my rhythm.
Oh, right.
With Phil before that.
Right.
And the opening sequence took many, many redos. But then once we got that, this is what Mike's looking for. This is his style.
Yeah.
That was a fun show to do.
Yeah, that was really, I really liked that one.
Oh, that's a great idea.
I remember going to, I believe it was the Dove Awards week when they still had CBA week during Dove mm-hmm. Awards week, and going into one of the events, and it was like an hour or like a half an hour before the event started, and they had this playing on the, you know, on the whole system over things. I just thought that was so cool. And there were people singing to the songs.
It's like, they actually know who we are.
That's right. And they know the words to the songs. Even if they are clearly written on the bottom of the screen.
That moment for me came when there was an interview in Contemporary Christian Music magazine with Out of the Gray.
Okay.
And somebody asked them, so what sort of music do you listen to? And they said, not really much of anything. Unless you include VeggieTales. I about jumped out of my seat. I was like, they know of us down in Nashville? That was so cool, because I was a big fan of their music.
Oh,
still
that's
am.
Cool.
Love you, too. This was fun to create. Okay, what makes a bit of French? Well, of course, you add right. the accordion to it, and everything becomes French or German by adding accordion.
Oh, and this is, the singing on this is, Phil and I multi-tracked. I don't know how many different parts we sang, but this is just the two of us singing, you know, probably 8 different parts each. Sounds like a whole group.
Amazing.
Because it really only is Jean-Claude and Philippe. All right. I like the little graphic treatment up on the mm-hmm. arm for the jukebox.
You're not going to sing, are you? Couldn't you just play your harp and I'll throw things?
This was another one we did in the live show.
Yeah.
Because I'm picturing Junior as a costumed character.
Right. He had to fit him into that little asparagus armor costume.
Yeah.
Yeah, the live costumes were really cool because, you know, they didn't have arms and legs just like these characters, and so they moved around with these, you know, coverings over them. So they had to scoot around under the costumes, which actually hit the ground.
Uh-huh.
And they manipulated the eyes with one hand and the mouths with another hand.
Wow.
So it was very cool.
Yeah, you had, well, we shouldn't give away all the secrets, but they had magnets to hold
the pupils
in
right,
place.
Right, so they could point the pupils.
Which on those first couple of shows, if you pull too hard, the pupil would fall off and fall
right.
onto the stage.
Children That's, would start crying.
Yes, go running from the theater. And Michael, what was Michael's name that did the design?
Oh, Michael Curry.
Michael Curry.
Yeah.
Fantastic guy who
yeah.
did the designs for the Lion King on
right.
stage.
Right. So, yeah, he did a great, him and his whole shop just did a great job with the live costume characters. Yeah, because they even pulled off this, you know, little, you know, asparagus bullet looking thing.
This was fun. Starting in this show, I was able to start incorporating some live instruments, in this case just the trumpet, but just adding a couple live trumpets to it really helped, and especially in the fight scene, going back and forth between little David with his little muted trumpet and then Goliath with the big drum beat was
yeah.
a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And that's such a good message in that song.
Mm-hmm.
Still relevant today.
To this generation. What's next?
Ooh, the Stuff Mart rap. We got rap. Letters on this, didn't we? Because it's a rap.
Because it's rap, yeah. I think it's more widely accepted. Remember
That's
that?
Mike.
Yeah,
That's Mike.
Yeah. I remember trying to explain that sound to you. It's like, no, it's like this foghorn kind of sound, but it's like somebody's doing it, you know? And I remember trying to get Kurt to, you know, do something like it. And you finally just said, here, just sing it, and then I'll affect it.
Yeah.
So, and I also remember having those little finger cymbals
yes.
in your office. So
there you can hear them way at the high end.
Yeah.
Actually, that's a hi-hat right there, but there they are.
Yeah,
you kept saying, boy, it still needs just something a little bit at the top end. And I just couldn't see finger cymbal in a rap song. And you picked them up and again, you were like, well, kind of something like this. And I said, well, let me record it quick. So got it in there.
All right. Bungee! This whole bungee started with a 5-pound can of tuna.
Huh?
The initial idea and concept for the song, you know,
okay.
And then I rhymed around 5-pound can of tuna. So,
come on.
I like Jimmy trying to cheer up Larry here.
I didn't get
forlorn.
Are there people besides me that get Jimmy and Jerry confused?
I get them confused all the time. I have to think about it before I say
secret?
Their name. Well, Jerry, I do Jerry's voice, and Jerry rhymes with Larry. So that's how
So that's who you... but that doesn't help the appearance. Like...
Oh, I never get their physical appearance mixed up.
Okay.
When I'm referring to them, I'll get their names mixed up.
Okay.
So, no. I mean, Jimmy is shorter and orangier.
Jimmy, okay.
I like this little exchange. Brr. Ooh, Larry's piping mad. He's the one that's responsible for losing his silly songs. And now it's time for silly songs. There's Larry deflating. You know, I should actually write this song.
Because people have said, well, what is that one?
Yeah, yeah.
It's not so, like we had actually written one. We're keeping secret from somebody.
But, you know, we could actually use that. We could use that same set, and I could just write a song about being stuck in a bear trap.
Yeah, I mean, we've got the first 4 seconds written. You know, what's another 4 minutes? Should be pretty easy.
That's right, that's right. And actually, I remember we actually had it recorded. She said to me, you're stuck in a bear trap, but you might need some help getting out. Remember? Yeah.
I don't remember that.
She said to him something, something, and I think that my moose may have gout or something. I forget what it was.
Gosh, we're halfway there.
Yeah.
Hey, those pictures
but that's
on
using the cheeseburger song, though.
Those pictures on the fridge, those are actual artwork sent in, aren't
that's
they?
That's right. Yep. And that corrugation on that cardboard is actual corrugation.
Corrugation? That's which is very cool. Love songs with Mr. Lunt.
Here we go. Yeah, we just, not too long ago, did the Belly Button song, brought back Mr. Lunt, but this is his premier solo act.
This was a fun song to do.
Yeah, I remember remember going out and getting Air Supply and Meatloaf albums?
Yes.
And then the animators...
Not related at all to this song, just getting just going out and buying them because we love them so much.
Yeah, that was the concept. We wanted 70s rock opera. And actually, somebody had recorded a Meatloaf documentary off of VH1.
Oh, I remember that.
And so...
I kind of like the guy.
Brought it in for the animators, and we watched it. So it was an interesting documentary, trying to pick up on Meatloaf mannerisms for Mr. Lunt's animation. And this is fun. I got to do the... I did this background stuff. That's what I did in my previous... work experience was 2D compositing and graphics, so I got to pull out the After Effects and do this big heart thing.
Looks like a
that.
Valentine's card right there.
It does. Yep.
On TV.
There was going to be a Valentine's
now this is
commercial.
This is the one that you had a completely different verse.
Okay.
Remember?
Uh-uh.
And this is the one that was the Spanish soap opera.
Oh, I'm forgetting this. What is this now?
Okay. Well, I'll just make up this right then. No, you did. This was the one that you had a verse written, and your wife, Lisa, said, wait a minute, no, that's the theme song to a Spanish soap opera that you always had on at home on TV in the background.
Oh, yeah, that's Spanish. Right, that's right, that's right. There was this one telenovela.
So for once, right. You didn't copy Beverly Hillbilly.
That's right, yeah,
you copied
it got stuck
something
in my head
else.
From a novella.
So I went back and completely rewrote the verses, and then used your chorus.
Right. Yeah.
And then at the end, as it builds up, I mean, this is typical how a silly song gets written. You would just sing to me into a little tape recorder just this line that you just kept screaming higher and higher, and there was some semblance of a melody kind of in there.
Right. Right.
But what was more important is that I got the sense of, okay, here's the emotion, here's the peak, here's the drive that you wanted to get.
Right.
And then to be able to take that and...
make real music out of it.
Yeah,
like right in here.
Yeah.
It's like I knew I didn't want it to be too melodic and kind of driving, and him to just sort of go crazy at the end.
And let's see, this is singing background. That was Ginger Tam and Rayanne Powell, who's now Rayanne Fitch.
Okay, yep.
And myself.
Yep. And we brought in a live drummer for this too, right? And
yes.
And a guy that actually mixed it. Like a real audio engineer.
Yeah.
We were real rock stars for this one.
Yeah, the drummer, Brad, that I played in a wedding band with.
Oh, cool.
Plays drums on here. It was a cool wedding band, though. I mean, I know a lot of people
as
think,
wedding
oh,
bands
wedding
go.
Bands, yeah.
Yep.
No, we were Johnny Best.
Oh, we played so long with those wrinkles in his face to get those to look right. Because if you go too far with it, it looks really gross.
Ooh.
Yeah, so there was a fine line we had to play with those little Mr. Magoo wrinkles. Because this is the first time, I think, and maybe the only time, Mr. Lunt has appeared without a hat. So we had to give him some expression, because normally what we'll do is we'll use the brim of the hat if on an eyeless character for expression.
Uh-huh.
So to kind of, to mirror, you know, brow line. But we had to give him those to give him some expression.
I like the restroom signs back there, the male and female cucumber.
Oh, yeah. Yep. A little cucumber in a dress. Poor Larry.
Position, I was simply acting in the public's best interest. We do have standards.
Here we go for the big reveal on the petition. Oh, and actually the petition that we're going to show here is the actual petition.
So you scanned that in.
We scanned it in.
So somebody might see their own signature there.
They could. Okay, so here it comes. There it is. That's the actual petition.
Save our silly songs.
It was funny because Dan Lopez, the guy that did the drawings for the Cebu song, he did the modeling for this, and he actually he either talked about it or did it. I can't remember. But he had like a little semi-automatic, you know, like a little machine gun. And so when Archie opened it up, there was this machine gun in there, just as sort of a joke. I'm like, no, Dan, we're not going to do that. And here's some little in the background there in the briefcase. There's some fan drawings of some of some characters that we threw in there. We scanned in there and threw those on.
So you mentioned Duluth.
Oh, okay. And here comes Moose Lake. Wow, Moose Lake.
Yeah.
So and then of course Moose Lake showed up in Jonah, and Moose Lake is going to play a prominent role in Minnesota Cuke. So that's Minnesota Cuke's base of operation.
Uh-huh.
So is it in Moose Lake?
Well, and both you and Phil have strong ties to Minnesota, so it's...
Yeah, we met up in the Minneapolis area.
And, you know, I performed at Valley Fair one summer.
Did you? Oh, yeah. So that's a pretty strong tie. That's a good one.
Get a little patriotic music in there kazoos.
Little Macbeth's speech here. I recognize that voice.
Hey, that...
I can't even do that falsetto right now. And I've got my falsetto on today.
Yeah, was that the two of us? In typical...
I think that was just you.
Men's choir fashion. Yeah, no, I don't remember. Yeah. I know I was singing it. I don't remember if you joined me or not.
Yeah, I don't think I did. I think you were there. This is in the land of DVDs. Wouldn't that be cool if there were real jukeboxes? I guess you'd lose your DVDs that or your CDs that way if you fed them into a jukebox. Or would you get it back?
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say the inspiration. I grew up, one of my favorite albums, I was a big Dr. Demento fan, but my dad had this album from a group called the Chad Mitchell Trio, and they were a, sort of a folk comedy trio, and I loved their music, and they had songs like Super Skier and Lizzie Borden and Hang on the Bell, Nelly. And so I just love sort of that folk comedy style. And so I wanted to, you know, when I did this song, I wanted to kind of tap that. And so when these guys are singing, the four guys, we made them into a quartet instead of a trio. But they kind of have that folk comedy folk feel to it as we go over, you know, go into the land of yodeling veterinarians.
Well, and this was so, I mean, finally Larry gets to yodel, which was great.
Yep, yep.
And it was great to write a true German-Austrian polka, because, you know, I led a German band in high school, and I actually had lederhosen like Larry's there that I wore.
Did you really? You got pictures?
Stored
well,
in a vault
Steve Holfish,
somewhere.
We've got some Easter eggs here. We've got some Easter eggs.
I don't think I have any pictures. Maybe I do. I'm not telling you. But this was, you know, this was one of those typical examples of you having a concept of, let's take these two completely separate musical genres, you know, a guy's quartet and a polka, and somehow putting them together in one song.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's just one of those fun things about collaboration that anytime you collaborate, you get things that you wouldn't get doing things by yourself. Because I'd never... wasn't that John Waba doing the voice on the phone?
It could have been.
I think that was one.
Okay, it could have been, yeah.
Hey, John, hope you're doing well. And I love that can. So, yeah, it's just fun to... you know, the challenge of, okay, let's put those two styles together and make them fit together.
Yeah.
Is just part of the fun of working on these silly songs.
Yeah.
That looks like my son's sippy cup on the stand back there.
That is also the wood cabin texture from the Christmas silly song.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Santa. You recognize it. We just use that texture in
now,
there.
Now, Robert Ellis did the bear at the end of this, right?
The I rawr. Think so. Yeah, he did. But then I think there was some issue. We had to re-record it, so I think I had to redo the growl.
Really?
Yeah.
I thought it was. Yeah. I thought it was a combination of more than one. Maybe a. I thought it
yeah,
was Robert.
Yeah, I mixed it.
And,
yeah, with a. Yeah, mixed it with.
With an actual one, bear growl.
Yeah, with an actual bear growl, and then maybe one that I did too, even back then. I can't remember. But yeah, we had to get some sort of a weird, you know, kind of not exactly human sounding, but not exactly real bear sounding.
Actually, back when we were working on this, Joseph Pulich had printed off some of the artwork, the original concept art of Larry and Mr. Lunton's,
uh-huh.
I mean, Padre in his nurse's outfit. And,
uh-huh.
and so I've got those in our son's room framed. Those are,
because oh, cool.
I just love the German theme there. So yeah, those are still on our wall.
Cool. And this song was done, this didn't show up on any other video as well. This was written specifically for this show.
So this was the new song for this show.
For this show, yeah. Yeah, we didn't want to just put out a simple, you know, just a compilation. We wanted to make sure people were getting, you know, something that they had never seen before.
Yeah, want to get your money's worth with VeggieTales.
That's right.
This was tricky, because you had a melody that we built, and but then to arrange it into four-part harmony,
uh-huh.
which involved you and Phil singing two parts.
Right, he was Scallion number one and Frank and Celery,
yeah,
and Mike and, Sage, and then,
yeah, and then
I'm the other
so
the
trying
lead
to
singer.
Teach all of you the parts and really getting it.
Right.
And there was a big discussion of how good does that sound? How good do we make it sound, you know?
Yeah, and I think it worked to actually, you know, get it as good as possible, you know, just because it is a tight, you know, just a tight arrangement with their little cartoon voices, so I think it turned out really well. And Joe McFadden did all the animation on those four guys all by himself, which was a big feat.
Wow, we're to the end already?
Man,
that
time just flies
fast.
Again. And see, there's the, and what we did here was we staged, for the credits, we staged the actual painting now of Nighthawks.
With
the characters. So if you look at the actual painting of Nighthawks, they're arranged in much the same way.
Now, is there the ice cream cone on the original Nighthawks?
No, there's not.
Okay.
And there's not a video jukebox back there either.
Okay.
So, but many other things are similar. So,
mm-hmm.
And there you have it. Well,
cool.
Well, maybe we should sign off now.
Well, hope you enjoyed it. Till next time.
Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.